Hello, friends. Another edition of In the Car with Star in the aftermath of yet another Montreal Canadiens loss, but not this time, my friends. They got a loser point. They got a loser point for the first time this season as the Canadiens played to a 3-2 overtime decision to the LA Kings. I've got my notes. I've got my notes written down. I like to take some notes when I watch the Montreal Canadiens play. I've matured in that way. There was a time early in my broadcast career that I thought my brain was super powered, that it would retain like a sponge. It would retain all this information, and then the next morning I'd be able to get up and recite that information and tell it to you in a good, entertaining, intellectual way. No. No. I write stuff down now. Much better. So let's begin with the positives, okay? I thought the best thing to come out of that game last night was how it ended for the Canadiens, or I should say how regulation time ended for the Canadiens. I understand Jake Evans scored a Connor McDavid-esque type goal. It was a beauty goal, full value for its artistic integrity that tied the game up at two, but it really was the push. It was the push that the Montreal Canadiens had, I thought, in that hockey game yesterday that should lead you to be a little bit more positive today, knowing that, yes, they did get a point, but it's how they performed, it's how they played, and yet it's still a point for this team that continues to struggle. And look, I mean, I don't think this team is going to make the playoffs. I think you should be closer to that mindset than you should be about them making the playoffs at 3-13-1 after 14 games, which reminds me of a text message I got from a friend of mine the other day about, you know, when Carey Price comes back, right? If he comes back this season, you know, is there a chance that he's going to lead them on this triumphant comeback, right, to the point where they just miss out on the playoffs and slot into the 14th spot in the draft order, right? And I wrote back to him, I go, worst case scenario, ? Because in my mind, that is worst case scenario. Like, either be great or be terrible. Don't be in the middle. Don't be good enough where you're the bubble boy team, you're on the outside looking in of the top eight, and now you draft middle of the pack for a team that has a disastrous track record of drafting well and developing well. What are they, 27th in the league from points by drafted players since 2003? Yeesh, that is terrible. That is a massive sample size, and the Canadiens are 27th in the league in that category. Which takes me back to a conversation we've already had numerous times here. Rebuild. To rebuild or not to rebuild, right? Like, and my perspective hasn't changed. If you're going to talk to me about rebuilding and having a serious conversation about rebuilding and tanking, then the rebuild begins in the front office. The rebuild begins with finding a new general manager, finding a new assistant general manager, find a new head scout, find a new director of pro scouting, and down the list of executives we go. Because how in the hell David Savard's contract got greenlit? Like, David Savard was a third pair defenseman with the Tampa Bay Lightning. And as Brian Wilde of Global Montreal pointed out in his latest piece, David Savard was a minus player on a great juggernaut team. And the Montreal Canadiens identified that and said, okay, let's sign this guy to a contract. I believe I know why the Canadiens signed David Savard to a contract. I really do. I think Marc Bergevin looked at David Savard, looked at the complexion of his group of defensemen, saw how his team was successful in the playoffs, and said, okay, let's add another one to the mix. Let's add a guy who's nasty in front of the net. Let's add another guy that's violent with his stick, can cross-check with the best of them. Let's add another guy that isn't mobile, that has more chuck in him than playmaker in him. And let's just get another guy that's cut from the same mold as Shea Weber and Ben Sherrod and Joel Edmondson. Let's get this guy on this team. And I believe that's why they signed David Savard. I do. I honestly believe, I think they signed David Savard for that reason more than I believe they signed David Savard because his name is Savard. Because David Savard is a train wreck. David Savard is in the healthy scratch realm for me. Like, the mistakes that this guy continues to make, he plays the puck over the man on the regular, but he's in that, like, Cedric Paquette where he's hurting more than he's helping, which puts us in this interesting scenario, but what that means for a guy like Matthias Norlander. You talk about unfair, man. Like, Matthias Norlander is going to get a look. He's going to get a few looks from this team because they're so poor on defense. They're going to force this guy who's never played in the National Hockey League to go on the worst defensive unit in the NHL and say, okay, let's see what you got, kid. don't worry about your confidence. We got you here, right? So, I don't know. That's buyer beware for me right off the hop. You know, the other negative for me in the loss to the LA Kings last night in overtime was the Iafallo goal 6 seconds into the start of the period, where, again, you know, David Savard didn't help there at all. He wasn't ready. Jake Allen wasn't ready to stop a fluttering puck that had some weight behind it. But without question, man, you have to make that stop. But are we really here going to dump all over Jake Allen? Absolutely not. He's the busiest, most overworked goaltender in the National Hockey League today. You know it. I know it. Jake Allen is not a number one goaltender, but this is where we are. This is where we are with the Montreal Canadiens, because Carey Price released a statement yesterday, as you know, he has come out of the NHL Players Assistance Program and released a statement yesterday. And I think it's important to distinguish that Carey Price, when he mentioned that he checked himself into a residential program here, that it was substance use, not abuse. Substance use, not abuse. I think there's a difference there. And look, you know, I've been pretty opinionated about Carey Price and what's gone on here, so much so that nobody has the right to know what's going on with Carey Price other than his family and people closest to him that he trusts with information, right? Like, I don't have a right to know. You don't have a right to know. Columnists, pundits don't have a right to know. It's not your life. Carey Price is like you and I. He has issues, and he's got peaks and valleys in his own life. We all share that in common, right? And before Carey Price released his statement yesterday, I honestly was of the opinion that if Carey Price is going to come out and say something, I think it's going to do a world of good, you know, for numerous reasons. One, it immediately erases speculation. And if Carey Price felt comfortable enough coming out and saying what was going on, the reasons why he put himself into rehab, then you took away the angle from the haters about, you know, who he is as a person or the reasons why he decided to check himself in to rehabilitation to get his life better and back on track, when he mentioned that he had been neglecting his own mental health for years, right? And I think that is an indication of Carey Price evolving and maturing as a human being, as a dad, and as a husband, right? And like, when we talk about leadership all the time, I think it's very easy to identify leaders on a team like Montreal that was rolling in the playoffs, coming back to beat Toronto, winning three rounds in the Stanley Cup playoffs, winning a game in the Stanley Cup final. Like, everybody loves everybody. Everyone's chilling after a game, going for dinner together, all that stuff, right? But like, when times are turbulent, when times are sideways and times are really bad, who emerges as a leader? Who steps up as a leader? That's what I look for. That's how I like to determine true leadership, right? Like, when I weigh it, like, who's coming out when the Canadiens are 3-10 after 13 games? Who's saying what? What are they saying? What are their attitudes like? And when I see a guy like Carey Price release a statement like the one he chose to release yesterday, that's leadership to me. That's leadership in tough times. That's leadership of a guy saying, you know what? I have been, on purpose, very quiet about what I think about the team after a win or a loss or a personal accomplishment or a banana goal that he landed. Carey Price doesn't let anybody know anything unless he wants you to know something. So for Carey Price to come out and make that statement and admit that he has been dealing with substance issues that he needs to rectify in order to get him right again in the head and mentally, that is leadership in tough times. That is a real character man right then and there. For a guy, again, who is always very, very quiet and always very specific with the words that he chooses to utter publicly. And I love the fact that Carey Price came out and said something. I do. I think there's a realistic chance that Carey Price could honestly alter the course of someone's life. I mean it. I mean it. Like, if someone watching me right now, right, or watching and reading Carey Price's words, said, you know what? If Carey Price can come out and say it, I can too. You know, there are people that look at Carey Price as a role model. They look at Carey Price as a hero. And they'll follow and march to Carey Price's beat. So I do believe, I kid you not, I do believe that when Carey Price made that impactful statement yesterday, someone's life was affected by it in a positive way. I hope so anyway. I really do. And when I see what Carey Price has done, it really impressed me. And I hope for him and his wife Angela and their three beautiful children that they can get back their dad and their husband and the man that they know and love, and they can get back to a life of normalcy. And then and only then, I believe, will Carey Price be ready to come back and resume duties with the Montreal Canadiens as their number one goaltender. And that's where we are with that. So kudos to Carey Price and the organization for taking the right steps and hoping that everybody can have a quick and successful recovery, and everybody can begin the process of just getting better. So I was very, very impressed by that yesterday. So I tip my cap to that. And the Montreal Canadiens will be back in action tomorrow when they host the Calgary Flames, which should be an interesting one. Calgary looking pretty good with some solid goaltending and Jacob Markstrom, who's rocking, what, a 940 save percentage. While the Montreal Canadiens had three forwards last night who iced less than 6 minutes. Granted, Cedric Paquette was hurt, but Alex Belzile and Michael Pezzetta also iced less than 6 minutes. And by the way, that was the Canadiens' first loss by just a goal since October the 13th, when they lost 2-1 to the Toronto Maple Leafs. And the other positive, before I let you go, and I apologize if I'm all over the place today, the other positive for me, and something I've been talking about for a little bit, was emotion. Emotion, emotion, emotion for a team that had been so bad and statistically terrible and no good vibes, good feels about this team whatsoever. To see Alexander Romanov steamroll an LA King player yesterday was beautiful. It was a sight to behold yesterday, I thought. Like, I honestly, I think on Monday, I wanted a Montreal Canadian player to fight. I wanted Benchrot to fight someone. I wanted Josh Anderson to fight somebody. I wanted to see emotion. I want to see someone be angry, take it personal that this team looked and has been playing so bad. And I got some emotion yesterday from Alexander Romanov. I thought it was a stud. Fantastic bounce back game from Alexander Romanov. So some of the positives, some of the negatives, and the Montreal Canadiens get their first loser point of the season in a 3-2 overtime loss. My thanks, as always, to my wonderful sponsors, Ash Gregoire, Shaman, and Nissan, for providing this a beautiful, luxurious Nissan Maxima SR. It is Quebec's number one rated Nissan dealership. Of course, Poutineville, Vaudreuil, Dorion. I hope you all saw the awesome commercial we filmed at Poutineville, Vaudreuil, Dorion in support of On Our Own. It's a great initiative to get women back on track. It is 03. We are doing a total drive on November 20th. So no one's asking you to go like Toys R Us or super expensive toys. Dollarama's just fine. A couple of new toys. That's it. A couple of new toys. Bring them with you when you come see Joey Elias November 20th at Poutineville Vaudreuil Dorion. You don't want to miss this show. It's Joey and friends. And of course, the Sean Star and Joey Elias poutine, $16. I think a couple of bucks, $2 or $3 from every sale of one of our poutines, the Joey Elias or Sean Star poutine, goes to benefit On Our Own. A great initiative. And we're doing our toy drive too on November 20th. So hope to see you there. Come by and say hi if you do see me at Poutineville Vaudreuil Dorion on November 20th. And of course, if you're going to get in your car, you need to gas up. And you're going to gas up at K-Stop Gas Bar and Depener, Highway 138 in Ganawage. Stop complaining about spending so much money. We work hard for our money. Why are we giving it to these greedy guys over here? We're paying for taxes out the wazoo, left, right, and center. Jump over the Mercier Bridge, Highway 138 in Ganawage, in the Playground Poker parking lot. It's K-Stop Gas Bar and Depener. Premium gas at discount prices. We'll see you soon.